everyone. Thank you very much for this very kind invitation. I really like this conference very much, especially the format actually that we have more time to discuss something, that we can interact with each other, and that we can explore things at night. I like this thing very much. And in fact, my talk is also building on kind of an interactive format, so I would like to expose you to some of the ideas that I'm working on right now.
And actually, I've implemented some questions to the audience in this talk, so I'm really happy to discuss with you what we're doing here. And I have the pleasure to talk to you before lunch and after lunch even. So, okay, good. So let me just give you just a little overview of where I am right now. So I'm in Dresden, so that's the capital of Saxony, one of the states here in Germany. So put it to you here on the picture. And I have the pleasure that my institute is actually very close to the city center. It's just 10 minutes walking distance to the city center, which is quite nice. And we are the Institute of Aerospace Engineering. And so I'm also head of the space systems chair. And the interesting thing about this connection here is that we got lots of students. So about 150 students every year are enrolling in aerospace engineering, and one third are specializing in space. So I get 50 master students doing space stuff every year, which is not bad. Huh? So if we have something interesting to jump on, we can do that. So that's the message I want to pass. So what are we doing in space here? Everything from CubeSats to energy systems. And actually, we are even building our own sounding rocket. And of course, the topic of today is breakthrough propulsion. Everyone who knows me knows that that's my passion. Yeah, so what I really like to do. And that's a kind of an outline of what I'm doing here in Breakthrough Propulsion, my dream program, so to say. So coming from a little bit of theory as a guideline, how to build maybe something hypothetically like a warp drive and so on, to mass modification, which is probably one of the key items. If you want to achieve that, right, it deals with mass or with something like how to manipulate gravitational fields even, and to test other claims. Yeah? So what have we done so far? So for example, we spent quite some time on investigating, for example, claims that gyroscopes change their weight. So we have done, I've done a couple of student theses on that topic, for instance. Or for example, I tested quite in detail if mass is being influenced by temperature changes. So coming from cryogenic temperatures to room temperatures, even testing superconductors to check if there's any kind of mass change when you pass the superconductor transition. You can all guess that it's already zero result, right? But anyway, so I've really been intrigued by this. For example, on the gravitational-like fields, we've recently done also null result measurement of a superconductor gravity impulse generator type of thing. So this has been put forth by Podkletnov and also by a French gentleman named Claude Poher. And so we built much more energy intense facility here, and much, much better sensors. And we haven't found here anything as well. Something this was on my to-do list for quite a long time. When I was a teenager, I learned that General Electric actually had a patent in the early 1970s, Henry Wallace, that if you rotate masses out of a special material with net nuclear spin, that that creates a gravitational-like field on another spinning object. And so I think I'm the first one who actually built this facility from the 1970s. It was also a very nice master thesis. And we found the effect from the patent, but also found the explanation of the effect. And it was not of gravitational, but of vibration origin. So unfortunately, anyway, yeah. So maybe some of you know my experimental activities in frame dragging at very low temperatures. So I've done this for 8 years. Then I had to take a step back to keep it on the table and let it rest. And now I'm coming back with some new ideas, and we're just assembling a new facility on that. And there will be hopefully some test results next year on that. So little twist on this, I'm trying to build the world's first cryogenic fiber optic gyroscope to test this effect with a new twist. Anyway, also testing other claims, for example, the M drive. Of course, my students are asking me, right, what do you think about the M drive? And I said, well, I can only tell you my opinion if I tested it myself, trying to find out all the flaws in the system, then I can give you an honest opinion about what I think about the EM drive. So I was looking for another master student who was doing the EM drive project. Yeah? And I'm going to talk about this here today, probably after lunch. Another thing that we did recently, well, last year actually, also on my to-do list for a long time, that has actually been published very well. Applied Physics Letters and so on, really very good papers. Two professors published an effect saying that if you have three spheres and one of them is charged and the other two are floating, that the two floating spheres are going to counter-rotate. It's a new type of electrostatic effect, they called it electrostatic rotation. When I first saw this from the paper, I wrote to this professor saying that if you really do observe, that the spheres start to rotate, you found the perpetuum mobile, right? He responded to me that he knows, but fortunately the referees didn't pick it up, so he could publish it. So I said, ah, it's interesting. So I got very good student again to trying to investigate the system. We built several setups and we found the rotation of the spheres. We found out the reason why the spheres are rotating, and it was, of course, a setup problem, and there's no new perpetuum mobile electrostatic effect, whatever. Very nice paper, and we put this in the Journal of Electrostatics because they claimed it's an electrostatic effect, and unfortunately found out it's not the case. Okay, so I'm very happy to speak to you today about the activities that are going on right now. So not everything from here. I will just expose you to maybe four ideas that I'm fooling around right now. Huh? So just to show you a little bit of the experimental equipment that we have. We have from large vacuum tanks and with cryogenic pumps to small, medium vacuum tanks. I have clean room facilities, I have cryogenic facilities. Glove boxes, whatever, so we can put all that, put this to good work to do some breakthrough propulsion research. The way how I approach this always to my students is, you're all aware of this, but maybe some of you aren't, so I'm just putting this in context. So our big problem is, right, if you want to go to the stars with present propulsion systems, you need propellant, right? And you need a lot of propellant, yeah? So if you have the best propulsion system there is, like Orion, so you drop nuclear bombs behind your spacecraft, then the amount of nuclear bombs that you need to go just to the next star, come back in 40 years, just the next star, you need the amount of mass of nuclear bombs is the mass of the sun. Well, that doesn't sound very promising, right? So, okay, it's not going to work like that, yeah? So good old Isaac Newton, everything is fine, but we need a trick here. There must be some trick here. And I like one quote from Jules Verne, right? Jules Verne, very famous science fiction writer. He said, everything that we can think of must be possible because we are part of nature, right? Our thoughts are of natural origin. So, it's just, you have to find the right trick. Yeah, so that's kind of a guiding thing for me. It's just a trick that we have to find, yeah? Once we know, it might be very simple, right? But just have to find the right trick. One trick could be something that has been elaborated by Jim and Heidi and so on, is that conservation of impulse is only valid for systems with constant mass, a very important thing. I find this illustration here very, very educational. Let's imagine you have a water drop, big mass, velocity, right? This water drop is going in this direction and it starts to evaporate homogeneously, right? So you evaporate this mass and the water drop becomes smaller, right? Smaller in mass. So what happens to its speed? Nothing, because everything was spent in a homogeneous way, okay? So from an outside you would say, hey, a conservation of momentum is violated, right? But in fact it isn't, because it's exchanged with the environment, and that's the important thing that we have to keep in mind. So the exchange with the environment can be through gravity, all around us, whatever. But that's, I think, a nice illustration of how to see that maybe that's one of the tricks that we have to apply. And then you can do the stuff that Jim is doing, no? That you can hop back and forth, for example, something like this, you can do that. The best trick, of course, is that not only by changing mass a little bit, but to do the real magic trick is to use negative mass. Every time, some non-physicists especially ask me, what negative mass? What do you mean with negative mass? Negative mass is, you can imagine it only in the following way. Imagine, you can all imagine that, right? You have positive mass, okay? And you are pushing positive mass. Well, it will accelerate in the same direction as you push it. Now, how can I imagine negative mass? I'm now David Copperfield, right? Just a magic trick. So I have negative mass, how can I find out it's negative mass? Well, I'm pushing on it, and it comes my way. So, really weird. It's not the usual tabletop experiment, right? We haven't seen, we're not exposed to this kind of stuff. But the beauty of this concept is, if there would be something like negative mass, and I'm only talking about inertial negative mass, I don't care so much about gravitational mass here, it's just mechanics, okay? Then imagine I have positive and negative mass, and I'm charging it up, for instance, such to create a force between them. This one is has a force over there, this one has a force over there, and this is positive mass, so it will accelerate in the same direction. But this one feels the force here, and it will accelerate in this direction. So you will start to generate a self-accelerating system. Well, that would be super. That would be really the warp drive we are thinking about and invented by Robert Forward. Yeah, so brilliant guy. And he also said that some people say, hey, you are violating the principle of energy conservation, principle of momentum conservation. No, no, because you have negative mass. This negative mass, when it's moving, it accumulates negative momentum and negative energy, and plus and minus is zero. So it's just its ground state, okay? So it's just, the thing is, where is negative mass? That's the thing, we have to find, we were digging so far, we haven't found anything. So maybe one approach to do it is to look if we can do something in the lab, maybe to find something like negative mass, negative inertia, to make such a thing come true. How can we do that? And maybe also here, kind of an illustration of, we have all heard about Mach's principle, right? So that inertia, that, well, mass is being influenced by masses here on the outside, and you can imagine that kind of this mass here, this little mass over there, has just some gravitational strings attached, right? So it's in contact with everything out there. And now the question is, can I attach maybe some other string? Because if this mass has charge, I can make some other strings, maybe some electric strings to it as well. Is this the same kind of inertia we are all talking about? Is this same, can we distinguish this? Or is it, this is because this is actually something which we actually already have in the lab. So we can play with that principle. So for example, it's called effective mass. In solid state physics, so let's say you have a semiconductor and you have an electron moving inside there. This electron interacts with the atoms in the lattice, and you can now imagine, yeah, that you have a free flowing electron without this, all these interactions, electric interactions with the lattice, and so you basically, you substitute the interaction of the lattice and just put it into its mass. So that's what it's called, an effective mass. You describe the motion of this electron by just assigning it a different mass. It just behaves like if it would have a different mass because it's interacting here with the lattice. And we can change the mass, yeah, drastically. Yeah, so we can have electrons in germanium, for instance, that behave as if they would have just half of its mass. Yeah, or you can have even more mass, okay? And maybe in some special circumstances, you can even have an effective mass which is negative, okay? And I'm just here putting forth the stuff, if we believe that inertia, it's maybe also due to gravity, so gravitational strings, then kind of this inertia must be from the very same quality as the inertia we are talking about, gravitationally speaking. So if I attach electric strings to it and I find a different mass, this mass is as good as the mass that I have just with gravity. And I will show you that that probably is really the case, and that we can probe, you know, how negative mass actually works. And if Newton is right or wrong about this, you can actually test this in the lab. And this is a very, very interesting thing because, you know, I really like writing down something sometimes. So imagine, you know, I told you this trick with self-sustained acceleration, whatever. It all relies on the fact that something here is right, and this is F is equal to M times A, okay? That's how we say, that's inertial mass, right? That's what Newton's, that's inertial mass. But of course, Newton at the time when he wrote it, he had no clue about negative mass or whatever. So it could be that he meant, oh, it's just the absolute value, for instance, yeah? Could be, yeah? So that there is nothing like negative mass out there, okay? But actually, the good thing is, he was right. So we can just take that away, okay? He was right, and that has actually already been shown in the lab, okay? And that's the thing that struck me, really, when I read about this. I'm going to show you an experiment done not by just someone, but by the best physicist there is right now in Austria, president from the Academy of Sciences, Professor Zeilinger. He got very famous with quantum entanglement. He performed this experiment in the 1990s, and I'm always wondering how come he didn't get the Nobel Prize for this one, yeah? It's the following. He calculated that when you have neutrons, he worked at the neutron source in Grenoble, so in France. So if you have neutrons with a very certain energy that go into a crystal at a certain angle, and this crystal has certain lattice structure, whatever, at certain conditions, these neutron beam splits. One has a positive effective mass and one has a negative effective mass. And he said, okay, now I have a beam of neutrons with a negative effective mass, and now I apply force on it and check if it goes, if it reacts like negative mass the other way. So he said, if I have my beams here like this, gravity is acting on it. If the mass is positive, well, the neutron is flowing down. And if the inertial mass is negative, yeah, right, then the neutron is flying upwards. And that's exactly what he found. He found that the neutron beam split and that the negative one is actually flying upwards in a gravitational field. Isn't that funny? Yeah. So effective mass, it's just as good as any other mass, okay? It works mechanically, okay, just as we would expect as negative mass does. So we can create the state of negative mass already in the lab. For example, okay, let's say for neutrons, yeah, inside a crystal structure, we can do that, okay? He also checked for the Coriolis force. He rotated his crystals and he saw that the normal neutrals, they were going outward, centrifugal force, the negative ones, whoop, were going inside. So it really, it's like, it's work F M times A, but there is now a minus. So that's possible. We can make negative mass in the lab.
And Martin, if it rises in the gravitational field, yep, that has finite mass, where does the energy come from to make it float?
It's just gravitational force law, right?
But I'm just saying, if the neutron floats up, nominally we'd have to give it energy. It's got more energy to rise, but where does that energy come from?
It's like a negative potential energy.
Sure, yeah.
It's like an opposite of potential.
Exactly.
It's not potential energy.
Well,
it's an experimental fact. So it's not a theoretical study case, but it's an experimental fact. So you may wonder, hey, next step. Can we make this self-accelerating system? That would be super cool, right? That would be a real warp drive. And now here comes the next best thing. That has been done in Germany 3 years ago. Has been published in Nature Physics, so not so bad. They found a system where you have photons coming into a metamaterial. And in this material, these photons can either get a positive effective mass or a negative effective mass. And every time they came together, and they started to accelerate towards the negative mass. So just like you would imagine from this kind of a warp drive. So actually they called this, they created an optical space drive. So, and the funny thing is, I mean, they are coming from communication, Max Planck Institute, looking at optics and communication and so on. And they invented this stuff to post-accelerate photons. It's so weird, right? To post-accelerate, they can accelerate photons with this, yeah? And they are saying, oh, this will have a big influence on communications of the future. And they were well aware of Mark Millis and Breakthrough Propulsion and so on. And they wrote initially that, we know that actually that's what the propulsion guys are looking for, but we believe this has no propulsion application whatsoever, right? It's just a couple of photons, right? So, but I said this, hey, so I mean, that's the proof that you can make a warp drive. I put this immediately out, you know, next to my door at university, yeah. Warp drive has been invented. It's published in Nature Physics in Germany, yeah. Not bad. So we know in principle, actually we can do it, yeah. Now the big problem is we have to do this not with photons, but with something else, and it should be a little bit bigger as well. And here in this case, of course, it's only working inside the special material. Anyway, these are big ifs, but in principle we have shown negative mass can be created and it actually behaves as if we need it to make a warp drive. Okay, so this is just my little intro on why I'm interested in mass and how to change, maybe find something like negative mass that would be really, really worthwhile from a propulsion expert point of view. Now, how can we modify mass? And maybe that's what I would like to tell you here in the next, couple of minutes. So that's my approach of what I would like to do. So how can we modify mass that may be linked to the M drive? Yeah. So we will hear also some theoretical thoughts about this afterwards. Maybe that's linked to that one as well. Well, Jim found out how to do this maybe in a transient way. So that's for sure on the list here as well. I will introduce to something that you may have never heard about, Weber's electrodynamics, which has been actually there before Maxwell's electrodynamics. So I will tell you something about this here as well, with its experimental consequences. Maybe you know that whenever there's a theoretical approach, I'm always trying to put this to the test to check if it's right or wrong. Yeah, there must be always an experiment, so that's what I'm doing here. And also, I had an idea a couple of years ago, if I can maybe create such kind of a state with what I call asymmetric charge distributions. So I will let you know what I mean with that. An electret capacitor. Yeah. So in fact, that's what it is. Okay. So actually, let's start with this approach right away. So what do you mean with negative mass coming from electrostatic fields? Yeah. So Jim has actually a whole chapter in his book about electromagnetic mass and so on. So I'm really looking for some input here because sometimes I cannot sleep thinking over all of this and is this right or wrong, whatever. So I have a couple of questions to you during this talk here. Let's start with this. It's very tempting to believe the following. Let's imagine you have two charges. They're next to each other. There will be an interaction energy, okay? And this interaction energy, we can say, well, E is mc squared, so this interaction energy actually contributes to mass. That's an old stuff, okay? So this was published 1978, no news here. But that's delta mass, and it's, of course, very, very small. The thing is, what I was wondering, where is this mass actually, where is it going to be? Do I change the mass of every individual particle just by, you know, I assign one half of this mass change goes to particle number one, the other half of this mass change comes to particle number two, or is it only, you know, in the field in between, yeah, then I can not do anything with the charges themselves. That's what I would like to do, of course, to do some propulsion stuff. So that's a big question here. And actually, for example, also Jim pointed out to me that Briolin has actually written a book about this stuff. And so he was convinced that if you look from the electrostatic field point of view, that actually most of the energy is actually surrounded around every source. So the charge on the left, charge on the right side. And he said, and from that he believes, that almost all of this energy is really split. And the mass of each particle is then accordingly, you know, different, okay? So that was his belief, yeah? And now I want to get a little bit deeper into that, yeah? I really want to discuss a little bit with you how he reaches this conclusion and if this is really worthwhile to do. Because again, if we can, with electrostatic energy, if we can change the mass, the effective mass of one of the charges of the particles, yeah? Ooh, that would be really nice for our propulsion stuff that we would like to do, if this is really true. So the way this was approached historically is the fact that you are saying, okay, let's just look at it from a single charge point of view, not the two charges, just a single charge point of view. So you have a charge, this charge has an electric field, and it has an electric field, and this electric field corresponds to an energy density. And we can calculate what's the energy from the electrostatic field from this charge, okay? This is actually quite significant, okay? But it depends, of course, on the radius, wherever you set the radius, you know, from this radius going to infinity where it's going to be. This was a big problem, right? Because if you say, if you point charge, the radius is going to zero, the whole thing is starting to be infinity. So that's a big problem, okay? So people started, okay, well, what's the natural radius here? And in the early days, they said, well, that's actually what we call the classical electron radius. It should be the classical electron radius. And then actually, there's a very good contribution, if not all, of the electron's mass is coming actually here from its self field, from its self electric field. So this is one of the ideas that have been put forward, okay? And that's also why Prinolin said that that actually if we do some changes in electrostatic field, that's actually going to be reflected in the particle's mass, because this electrostatic mass, that's how it's called, is actually, you know, good part of the electron's mass is actually due to the self energy mass, and if you modify the field, it's going to change its mass. Okay, this was the classical approach. Now, let's go to a different approach. How is actually general relativity dealing with charges, okay? So, well, maybe some of you know, there's a famous approach to this. It's a so-called Reisner-Nordström metric, where you can see that actually you have, here you have the potential energy from, of course, the mass. And here you get the contribution, the energy contribution from charge, okay? And now we get to a real problem here. Because if I go back this slide, I'm saying that, let's say the electron, there's some electromagnetic mass associated with its charge. And the charge, I mean, the energy is Q to the square. So the electrostatic energy here is always positive, E times C square. So it's a positive mass, okay? It's positive mass. Now, how this is done here in general relativity is actually exactly the other way around. Here you're saying that actually you need something like a negative mass, okay? It's a different sign, okay? It's a different sign, okay? So you need negative mass. So the equivalent here, if you say you include this in mass, would be that you have, this is a negative mass contribution actually, you see? That's called the Reisner-Nordström repulsion, even, yeah? So if you have charge in general relativity, you're saying that, okay, that would correspond to something like a negative mass, which is being created inside the event horizon, okay? So that's exactly the other way around, okay? And so if you take that into account, yeah, so you can have the view that if you have your electrostatic energy on the outside, yeah, and you think this is contributing to mass, if you look at this approach, actually all that is shielded inside, yeah, from general relativity and at the particle's location itself, that actually corresponds to negative mass. So that it's exactly balanced, okay? So at the core, there's a negative mass contribution that balances the electrostatic mass contribution from outside the field. So that in total, there is no mass change here, okay? So that made me very depressing. So which view is correct, yeah? So probably this is the more complete approach here that you have to take this into account, and that's one of the questions. So Jim, well, here you send me a little reference from where you calculated exactly using this metric. So if you have something with a phonograph generator to be charged up very highly, then of course this corresponds according to this metric to a little mass change. And of course this mass change is so small that the gravitational influence on the outside, you can never ever measure this. And it has been tried long time ago, right? 1930s or whatever, nothing new here, but you wouldn't even expect to find here anything new, okay? But that's the question I'm going to ask you, for example. What do you think? Is electrostatic potential energy linked to particle's inertia? Or is all that kind of a null game? So that's a question maybe we can discuss this over lunch or so, maybe. But this is something that I want to throw here in the audience. Anyway, there is no experimental proof that if you put some electrostatic energy into something, that this really contributes to a mass change. So I'm not aware of any experiment if someone has charged up something, you know, to a certain extent, that you could measure here something like a mass change that has not been done. But whatever, if this is right or wrong, I would like just to show you that with an asymmetric distribution of charges, you can at least get the field distribution in such a way that you would get the field distribution corresponding to a negative energy, a negative mass regime. Yeah? And maybe with this approach we can find out if there is something here to gain or not. So how did I approach this question? Imagine you have a capacitor. Okay, capacitor means you have a plate, you have another plate, some dielectric in between, and you charge it up. How do you do this? Well, you take one charge from one side, whoop, take that away, put it on the other side, and that's how you charge up a capacitor. Which means you have always the same amount of charges on the left side than on the right side. Okay? How can we calculate the energy that is stored in a capacitor? We all know famous formula, right? It's half the capacity times the voltage that I apply to the square, okay? Now that's the classical expression. You can even look a little bit down inside the macroscopic sphere, how I call it, and you can add up the energy contribution. You can say, actually this classical equation, you can really sum it up, is in fact, it's really true, it's due to the following, that every charge is interacting with every other charge here on the on its own plate, and it's interacting with the charges on the other side, okay? So you have to sum up all the possible interactions, okay? So you get the electrostatic potential energy, and of course, the interaction on the same plate, it's always same charge by same charge, so the sign will always be positive, the product is always positive, okay? So the self-field interaction on every plate is always positive, and you will get a minus contribution from the interaction from one side to the other side because of plus times minus, and it's minus, okay? So, but on a capacitor, bad luck, very big self energy here, very big self energy here, and a little interaction energy here, so the energy that you get up here is always positive, and it's always half C times V to the square. Now comes the trick. Well, I want to invent something new. I want to invent a capacitor where you do not have the same amount of charges on the left than on the right side. Yeah? You may ask, well, how do you do that? Okay, do you prohibit some electrons to come over or so? How do you do that? Yeah? Well, the approach to do here is to have something like an electret capacitor. We know that permanent magnets, right? We are all aware of permanent magnets, right? No problem. But you know, there's the same thing also for electricity. The so-called electrets. You can have materials with permanent electric charge. And that's what we would like to use here. So I would have permanent electric charge over there, yeah, and permanent electric charge over there. And I just have to use different charge densities such that I can achieve such a system. And then I can do the math. I can calculate. I can say lots of positive energy here, little positive energy here, and lots of negative interaction energy, so that it can find a regime where actually here this part should go completely negative, and even more negative than the rest mass energy from the charge carriers themselves, okay? I did the calculation, checked how this is possible. Just believe me, there is a kind of a negative mass condition where you need a certain density, a certain geometry to make that happen. And then in that case, you can really go into this kind of negative mass regime. So it's possible, in fact, with experimentally available, yeah?
So what would you get if you discharge it?
I discharge it. Was this capacitor? Well, the thing is, I cannot discharge it because the thing is, I cannot discharge it because for a discharge, I need to connect the charge carriers to an electric conductor, right? And the electret is made of an isolator. Okay, so I have an isolator, okay, and then I'm bombarding it with ions or with electrons, and they just stick there to the surface.
Okay.
So I cannot put a cable in there and you know, I cannot make a discharge, okay? I can maybe make a surface discharge if the fields are very high and then the electrode is gone, okay? But there is no discharge, no current flow.
So this is an electric capacitor like as in a circuit. This, what you're proposing here would be just sort of a device that contains negative mass, like a negative mass battery of some kind, right? But what do you do with that? How are you able to extract the benefits and the usefulness of negative mass out of that construct?
Come here. The thing is that, I skipped it here in my slides, but you can read it up in my paper, if it would be true that this potential energy manifests itself into change in mass of the charge carriers themselves, then the electrons in that case would go into a negative mass regime. So you would get, on one side of electric capacitor, you would have your charge carriers, which are now presenting negative mass. And now I have something in the lab which contains negative mass that I can carry around. Best thing is, it even has electric charge, so I can put a force on it. Okay, and with this force, I get exactly this trick that I can maybe make something like a kind of a warp drive. Okay, so that's my thought from an engineering perspective, how to build charge negative mass.
So you could carry around and you're applying a force in one direction to move it from one place to the other, would you be able to move it at all?
Look, there are many ifs, there are many ifs, there are many ifs and...
Right, but if you're pushing, how does it drag you, right? It's kind of crazy. Oh, yeah.
Instead of pushing, that's weird.
So if I really achieve that, I will sell it by the minus kilogram. Sure.
Martin, this looks like Ron Kita's. Are you using Ron Kita's verifying his patents, or that's based on?
I put to the test. Yes, it's coming up. Yep. It's not exactly what he did, right? Because he only has a singly charged electrode. So I'm talking here about two electrodes with opposite charges with very different charge distributions. So totally different.
Okay.
Yeah. But that's my idea how I would, if that Briolin approach is true. Yes.
You're basing this more or less on the electric field between the plates, right? So have you looked at, looping it back to Paul's talk, you have two dissimilar sized plates. One's got to have a dielectric in front of it versus the other.
So that's what I'm saying. It may also work for asymmetric type of discharges and whatever.
So I'd be kind of interested to see if there is a synthetic effect being created that does the same thing.
I'm interested too. That's why I put the student to work on this, of course. Okay, so that would be something. But I'm not really convinced yet if this theoretical foundation is valid. But it's a hunch, okay? So and we can put it into test, okay? So those are, time is running, so anyway. But I have a paper about that, and you can read it up, okay? Now I'm going to approach a second idea that also involves electrodynamics, and it's called Weber electrodynamics. So let me just introduce you to this concept a little bit. Wilhelm Weber, okay, a German fellow, and he thought of a very elegant way of how to combine, like Maxwell tried, right? How to put all this known electromagnetic phenomenon kind of into one package to explain it, right? And instead of four equations that Maxwell came up with, he came up with only one equation, yeah? Very elegant equation. He said, there is nothing else but the Coulomb's force law. Charge one, charge two, divided by R square, okay? So that's the Coulomb force law. That's what there is. And now if I have charges in motion, depending on the relative velocity and relative acceleration between the charges, this force law is going to be modified. That's what he said. It's a very elegant way. You don't need fields. No electric field, no magnetic field. It's just the force, yeah, one force law, and it just depends on the relative velocity or acceleration between the particles, okay? That's a very elegant way of doing that. And in fact, you can find out that, actually he has been the first one, Weber Kohlrausch, the two of them, I think 1853, a long time ago, they measured this constant C in the equation for the first time and said, hey, it's 10 to the eighth. They didn't know about the speed of light there yet, but they were the first ones to measure this constant. Wilhelm Weber, this guy, the unit of magnetic flux, right? So Weber, so that's this guy. So he really knew what he was doing there. And the thing is that this part here, very simple, That covers what you know from Maxwell's equations, okay? But there is this part here too, that there should be some dependence also on, there is an acceleration dependent thing going on here. And actually, that translates to the following experimental consequence. Imagine that you have a charged sphere and you have an electron inside, okay? The electron is moving. You will say, classically speaking, hey, doesn't care, okay? It's inside a Faraday cage. There's an electric field, the electron feels nothing, okay? Now, Weber says that that's not true because there's a relative acceleration between this charge and the charges all around there. And actually, because this force is proportional to its acceleration, you will say, hey, I know that force, acceleration. So what he means actually is that there is a kind of a mass contribution due to relative acceleration of charges between each other. Okay, so you can make something like an effective mass. You could change inertial mass of charges if they accelerate in a close vicinity of other charges. Okay, this effect is very small, of course, otherwise we would have noticed it long ago experimentally. And you have to charge up a sphere up to 1.5 megavolts, which is quite something, and observe single electron movements, and then the single electron actually would not move at all because it has zero mass. That's a prediction. Funny thing is that, of course, Weber came out with his theory, and Helmholtz said, hey, he immediately realized this. According to your theory, we could make something like negative mass. For sure, that's not going to be possible, so your theory must be crap, okay? So, and said, oh shit, we could have lost here something. I mean, that's maybe too premature, right? I mean, but this was 150 years ago. So it took, in fact, indeed, 150 years that someone had the courage of saying, let's try to find out if he's right or wrong in an experiment. And he did experiment and found out that Weber was right. Then two other fellows in Canada said, well, that can be true. So they made another experiment, checking if this is right or wrong, and found a null result. So everyone was again happy, saying that, hey, so Weber was wrong after all, stop. No one actually thought if the experiment that these guys were doing is actually representative of testing this effect. So that's what I'm doing. So I'm trying to see if this is actually true. I mean, if the experimental setup, the prediction here is that you have a single electron inside a charged sphere. What the other guys were doing was to take a neon discharge lamp and trying to see if the frequency of oscillation of your neon lamp is affected by, you know, the outside charge of this Faraday cage. Well, a neon discharge is much more complex than a single electron in a charged sphere, right? So you can do the analysis and you can, with the right analysis, you will see that in fact, you will never ever measure this influence with this experiment. So it's still open. It's still open if Weber here was right or wrong. That's the important thing here.
It's not a full force, because he's missing radiation reaction terms. He's only got optics acceleration. So he's got some of the terms. And of course, radiation reaction is really, really tiny. So way back whenever that was, he probably didn't know about it. So that's probably excusable.
Okay. Yeah. Coming to this. Well, just to tease you, if that would be right, yeah, you can build something like, now again, a charge capacitor, and inside this huge charge, it would start to self-accelerate, so the build is kind of a warp drive here with electrostatic means using Weber electrodynamics. But that's actually what I want to show you. So it really took, so Mikhailov, 1999, I think, he did the first experiment with this neon discharge lamp, and he saw this, oh, hey, the frequency is varying, so that means that the mass must be varying too. And so Weber was right, and then, this gentleman here, they tried to approach this with an optical measurement, found a zero result, and I put two students here to work to check if this is really right or wrong. And I mean, I could verify both. I could see that with his approach, I could see the variation with that approach, I couldn't. And I could also kind of trace it down to a problem here, one of the capacitors here, that there was an influence, a kind of a leakage current, that they misinterpreted it here, so that's okay. Nevertheless, question is still valid if this experiment is representative to test the whole effect. So actually there was a second experiment which was probably much more valid in this respect, and it's something that deals again with Dresden, fun enough. It's the so-called Barkhausen Kurzgenerator.
Maybe you know Barkhausen oscillations and so on. Maybe you've heard about Barkhausen. Yeah? Barkhausen was the world's first professor in electrical engineering. Interesting enough, at the University of Dresden. So long, long time ago, the first electrical engineering professor. And they were all playing with tubes, right? They were these vacuum tubes, beautiful vacuum tubes, okay? And actually he found out that if you have some kind of a grid here and you have some electrons that you inject into the system, that certain voltages or whatever, these electrons will start to oscillate on this grid around. And that gives you a very particular frequency. And actually, that was the method up to World War II to produce high power, high frequency fields. Here, this was the Barkhausen-Kurz oscillator. That's what they used here. And here, it's much more easy to see that you have electrons oscillating here. This oscillation is, of course, goes with one of the square root of its mass. So if I put the Barkhausen-Kurz oscillator inside such a big charged sphere, indeed, probably if I see a frequency shift here, then I know that the mass of the electron actually has been changed. And that's what Mikhailov also tried to do. And he also said, oh, I'm seeing something like a frequency shift. This is exactly what Weber actually predicted. And truth is, of course, if you do it right, that's also people publish things, whatever, yeah, but it takes at least usually 1 to 1.5 years to find out your electrical setup, the problems, and so on. And we rebuilt his setup in very big detail. Actually, I got the same vacuum tube from Russia that he was using from a museum to put this into practice. And we found out that actually he has never ever seen Barkhausen-Kurz oscillations. So we really had a spectrum analyzer and so on. It's what not what he had. And so we found out, so when you go to the right Barkhausen oscillator regime and you put this into a Faraday cage that you can charge, that's what we would have expected, plus or minus variation of the mass, depending on what you do here with the outside shell, then that's actually what we have measured. Yeah? However, you can see the spectrum analyzer. We take here the maximum point to determine the frequency, but there's a big error bar here, okay? So it still maybe could be, if you have a positive approach to this, that maybe still we have to do a little bit better than that. So I have another student preparing the next setup to get even better, to really check if this is right or wrong, because it would be such a very elegant way of how to control the inertial mass of electrons if Wilhelm Weber was right. And in fact, shall I say this now or after lunch?
Say now.
Say now, okay. Well, I'm just here to entertain you, right? So no problem here. The thing is, there's a professor in Brazil who spent all his professional life in investigating the consequences of Wilhelm Weber's work. Professor Andreas Süß at the University of Campinas. I think, Jim, you know him. Excellent guy. This guy knows it all in electromagnetics. He spent all his life in studying electromagnetics and applying it to Weber's theory and so on. Excellent guy. He wrote a paper in, 1992, Canadian Journal of Physics. When I saw this paper, it completely struck me. What? This paper is about how to derive gravity as a fourth order electromagnetic effect. I said, what does he mean? I immediately invited him as a guest professor to my university. So we had some fun. that's great. How do you do that? The Weber law of electromagnetics. This is the Weber potential energy, and you can get the force equation by deriving the potential energy, then you get the Weber's force law, okay? Now, Aziz said, what if, that's just the first approximation, what if there are many more terms, you said radiation, whatever, what if it's just a series expansion, right? So there's 1 over c squared, there's maybe 1 over c to the 4, and so on. What if there are many more terms, okay? So maybe Weber just had the first guess, initial guess of what electromagnetism is. Let's just expand these terms. Yeah? And then he said, let's put this into test. Let's see if gravity, if mass, it's maybe even more important, if mass actually has some kind of electrostatic origin, if mass is due to electric charges. How can you show that? He said, okay, let's make the most simple approach. You have mass, and mass, let's say, is being composed out of two charges. that oscillate, okay, next to each other. So seeing from the outside, I would say, hey, it has no charge, yeah, but it's because, you know, on big on the outside, you don't see this, but if you really zoom inside, you have these two charges, these two charges oscillate. And you have here another mass, also consisting of an electric oscillator, okay? And by the way, when I saw that, actually, it's a kind of a variant of string theory, right? You have a string, string is vibrating, okay? But the big thing here is that the string has charges on one end and on the other hand. So that's the new thing here. That's really exciting. And he said, okay, now let's see if there's kind of a force acting on them. And he took this extended Weber energy, and he found out that indeed, if these oscillators look at each other, there's a kind of a van der Waals force. So an attractive force going on between them, which you may interpret as mass, gravity, whatever and so forth, okay? So he found an equation, okay, so it's a little bit much, but it says it depends on the amplitude and on the oscillation of these little oscillators here, they oscillate back and forth. And you could identify that this one here, it's a 1 over r square law, that actually this is what we call the gravitational law, okay? So that's mass somehow. Mass 1, mass 2 times the gravitational constant, okay? And then actually inertia is a kind of a sixth order magnitude effect, so he could see this here as well. When I tried to work with this model, put in a paper, I thought it was a brilliant paper, and of course every time a physicist writes a paper, right, he thinks he gets a Nobel Prize for this, huh? And so I thought, oh, a really great idea. So, and I put this in the paper, and I was trying to work with this model. And then a referee pointed out to me that, hey, that's not a stable configuration, because if you have two charges that oscillate, they would radiate power, and the whole thing actually, you know, stops to work immediately, yeah? Oh, that's a really good argument, yeah, that's a really good argument, yeah? So I was going to sleep and whatever, and I think it was Saturday morning, yeah? I was still, you know, in bed at 8 o'clock in the morning, yeah? And boom! And, oh my God, that's actually the argument I was looking for! Immediately going to my desk, yeah? And the thing is, he's absolutely right to point out here something very critical, yeah? So, if you look at just one charge from this string alone, okay? So, one charge alone has no mass, because the mass comes into effect as a consequence of two charges oscillating. So the single charge on the string is actually massless. Okay? So I checked if anyone has ever investigated electrodynamics for charges that have no mass. Turns out that this is a very recent thing in theoretical physics since 2006. People are seriously investigating this, hypothetically, what happens. And one consequence is that charges with no mass do not radiate energy. So it's a stable configuration. I said, hey, that's interesting. So it is, in fact, a stable configuration. So I tried to put this into work. And I said, well, how can I put this into work? And I would like to calculate a certain mass, right? But the thing is that I have here too many factors that I'm not aware of what it should be, you know? How big is the amplitude? How fast are they wobbling around, yeah? I have too many free parameters. I mean, I can fix everything if I fix the frequency. But so, is there a special mass that I can calculate? I said, oh, sure. There is a special mass I can calculate. It's the Planck mass. The Planck mass is the maximum mass, point mass, which is allowed by general relativity. Because if the mass would be more, then the Planck mass at the point, whoop, you would have a black hole. Okay, so that this very special mass, the maximum allowed mass there is. And I said, okay, can I calculate here the maximum mass that is allowed in this model here as well? I said, yeah, sure, I can do that. Well, just to show you that it makes sense if the amplitude is on the order of an angstrom and the frequencies are in the gigahertz range, you will get something like the proton. This is what Aziz had already in his stuff. But I said, okay, let's put this into work. Let's say, well, that's according to Aziz's model, that's how mass would look like. So it consists of a charge, it has an amplitude, it has a certain frequency, and I'm saying that, well, the maximum speed before this stuff can here oscillate here is obviously the speed of light. With this, I can neatly fix the maximum amplitude and frequency that then fix together, and nice enough, some things start to drop out, okay? So they start to drop out, and I have an expression for the Planck mass, which is depending, of course, on G, like we already know it does. It's electric constant, it's pi to the 3, and you have this factor beta. Maybe you remember this was in this Aziz equation. So you have from all this 1 over c square, 1 over c to the 4. There's always a prefactor which is an order of unity, but which has to be determined by experiment. But just know it's an order of unity, so it's a very small correction factor. Now I say, okay, well, that's what we call the Planck mass. So I can use that to calculate actually h bar. I can calculate the Planck mass, the Planck constant with this. And indeed, when I write this down, first time I put this in the pocket calculator, I said, what, 10 minus 35? That's not so bad, yeah? So actually I could derive the Planck's constant, okay? So Planck's constant depends on charge to the square, speed of light, electric constant, so that's not so bad. So if you have now a model that has electromagnetism, that can give a model of what mass actually is, and actually we can derive Planck's constant, we found the foundation of quantum theory. That's not so bad. So this model, if that turns out to be somehow true, we can maybe find a link here. We can say, well, then if mass is really due to oscillation of charges, very small level, but maybe then polarization of mass, electric polarization of mass, may influence mass itself. Okay, so that's actually what I will show you experimentally, maybe after lunch. Okay?